driving around in the fifth gear, 60 kilometers an hour. One thing I've noticed, the gears in this car, the gearing is very long, you know. In a Volkswagen DSG, say DQ200, I would be in 7th gear at 60 kilometers an hour. Whereas in this car, I'm at 5th gear in 50 kilometers an hour. And I am yet to see a situation where I've used D7. It's pretty long gear, particularly 3rd gear is very long. I mean, maybe that's also one of the reasons it's slower to 100. And I think that's a missed opportunity here by Hyundai, that maybe they could have given, since this is their so-called N line, so they could have given the car a better, a better gear, shorter gearing to make more use of the power. Maybe the fuel economy is not that important for people driving this car. Not that I'm complaining, fuel economy on an unbroken in car with hooning is about, right now it's saying 10 because since start I've been hooning a bit, but I can get easily 14-15 kilometers per liter on this car, which is very good for a 1 liter engine. And if you get lighter wheels and wider tires, fuel economy gets even better. So yeah, in terms of braking, that's a interesting part about this car. The braking in this car is different. I mean, initially when I first test drove the car, I was like, wow, this has a very, you know, a very spongy brake pedal. And I thought maybe because of the test drive car that the brake pedal was spongy because they've been driving it a lot. But even when I got my car, the brake pedal was not as spongy as the test drive car, but yeah, it is spongy. But and it's actually very different from the Volkswagen brake pedal that we are used to in most German cars. In most German cars, the initial bite of the brake is really good. So, you know, when you press the pedal, you can really feel the car slow down very fast in the initial part of it, part of the brake application. And then the brake, basically, the brake biasing takes over, ABS takes over, and the brake pressure fades. Whereas in this car, it's exactly the opposite. In this car, it is, your initial bite is very little, so you need to get used to that. But as you progressively apply the brakes, the brake pressure keeps on going up, up, up. So it's not like this car is lacking brakes. If you're coming from a Volkswagen or any kind of German car, it does take a bit of getting used to. I remember the last car that had brakes like this, you know, which are basically low to mild initial bite and progressively get stronger, was the Japanese car, the Mitsubishi Lancer, the Toyota Corolla. All of them had the same feel to it. And that is what this car feels like, the braking in terms. So you have enough brakes. This car is not lacking for brakes at all. And you just need to understand how the brakes work in this car, as to, let's say, working in my Octavia RS or my, you know, Tiguan. So initially you'll see the first few millimeters of travel, you get a little bit of brake, and then the brakes start kicking in. The initial first few millimeters of braking will take a bit of getting used to, but you get used to it pretty fast. I've driven this car 220 kilometers, 26 kilometers, but 6 kilometers, 7 kilometers, I think about 10 kilometers I can give to visit, because it drove the tits of this car. So, and 220 kilometers, I've gotten used to it. My wife has been driving this car a little bit also, so she's also gotten used to it. She actually prefers it. She felt that the Volkswagen brakes on my Octavia RS were a little grabby. I like it that way, but for her, this is a better braking system. For me, I'm indifferent to it. I mean, not that I'm going to race in this car ever, but you know, I'll take it to a track maybe once or twice. But this is primarily for tuning, right? It's a decently slow or moderately okay hatchback, you know, quick hatchback. It handles great. It's a 1 liter engine, so I'm not going to be paying so much fuel tax to the government. And it can run on most fuel, so there's no issue on the fueling also. Now, again, Hyundai, because of the issues with the DCT initially, of the clutch overheating in stop-and-go traffic, whenever you're in traffic, put it in neutral. Just save peace of mind, so you know, there'll be no issue. And when the light turns green, put it back in D, and you can drive away. Just issue. I think the software update has fixed that heating issue that they had in the initial batch of the DCTs, but just to be safe, just put it in neutral whenever you're stuck in traffic. One thing I also noticed in this car is that unlike the initial lot, particularly this Venue in front of us, which had the 7 DCT, the car's holding the first gear longer in traffic, whereas I remember in the Venue it used to upshift to 2 immediately. I mean, the moment you let off the gas, one or two centimeters of the wheel rolling and you're in second gear, and that's a behavior I think that was causing a heating issue in the gearboxes. In this car they've changed it, so gear ones holds for a lot longer. I think 10 kilometers an hour, 15 kilometers an hour it holds in traffic, in stop and go traffic, so it doesn't have that issue of the gear the clutch pack overheating because the clutch slips. So that's a good thing. All right, we are clear from traffic and we're back. So let's talk a little bit about this engine, the 1 liter turbocharged 3-cylinder engine. Now both the Polo and this car have very similar engines. This car has a higher stroke than the Polo, so it is a slightly higher compression engine than the Polo. So any person who's driven turbocharged engines will tell you that if you have a turbocharged engine, the higher octane you put, the better the car behaves. So I did exactly that. So I noticed the engine compression ratio was a little higher than the Polo, so I said let's put in a tank of 100 octane, and wow, what a difference. And this car isn't even broken in, so if I put it in sport mode, I'm 50 kilometers an hour. Press the gas. The shove you get is crazy in this car. And this car really, it goes, you know. And the fact that this car is lighter, so definitely helps. So yeah, I mean, it has the shove for it and feels quick. I don't know, I'm not looking at the speedometer much, but it really feels quick and it handles so well, you know. Braking, you saw right now, no issues. It broke extremely well, zero problems. Let's see if I can get this. Okay, alright, everybody's honking. Come on, guys. Yeah. Let's get this up. I mean, not that I can, or can't say bahar hai. Let's see if I can keep up with this. U7, what is this? 45 PSI? TDI. Always the SUV on this road once, so you can screw it. So yeah, not bad. 100 octane, I'm sure it's making the published figures. On lower octane, you know, Akshay Titus of GT Tuners, he dynoed one of the older base i20s, and he said it was making less power than advertised. So his remap, I think, pushed it up to 140 horsepower-ish. Most 1.0 TSI does that. Can you do this in a stock Polo TSI is the question. Suspension is scary on that car. Stock suspension is definitely a lot scarier. The front end doesn't have this much grip. Okay. And you'd think twice, the steering doesn't have any feedback in that car. It takes a lot of modification to get some steering feedback. I'll go back to D and chill. Happily left behind. See, it's like a Jekyll and Hyde. You put it in D, the car completely kills all power. You can just press the you really press the accelerator hard to get the car moving. It goes into efficiency mode basically. Your throttle response goes away, your turbo spool goes away. It keeps the RPM just below the turbo spool, so you won't have any issues in that. But when you put it in S mode, the car comes alive because I love a Q7. The car really comes alive because then the gearbox keeps the car in the right gear, you know, for acceleration. The handling is perfect. I don't want to do this. Given up, and I don't think I should drive like an asshole that I've been driving like.